We're going to talk today about robotic-assisted knees, and we're going to talk about the who, what, why, when, where, all of this. We have a plan that we're going to go through, again, kind of who and what it really is and what a knee replacement is. We'll talk about that a little bit, and then robotics, and then we're going to do a demonstration with our Corey robot that's here right behind me. Why does someone need a robotic knee, and then how do these things work, and we'll do all that. So. If you have questions, go ahead and hit the next slide. If you have questions, there's a chat function. We want everybody to stay muted in these things. We do know that if everybody's talking, then no one can hear and we get lots of feedback and that's all doesn't work. So, if you have a question, we're happy to answer questions. I want them to come through and have some help here in the room that is with me. Everybody here is vaccinated and tested, so we're far apart here, so my mask down, it should be fine. And if you have questions, send them through, and Ryan will feed them to me as we get going. So we're going to get started here. I think I'm okay in the page here, so all right. So first off, who needs a knee replacement? And anyone who's a knee replacement is a candidate that has knee arthritis, either any type of arthritis that's wear and tear and pain in their knee, that's failed conservative treatment. So when you see these things here, that anti-inflammatory medications, physical therapy, different injections such as cortisone or Orthovisc or platelet-rich plasma, stem cells, all those kinds of things are possibilities. Exercise, treating arthritis and treating knee pain is an entire hour-long lecture in itself. So, we're going to move on a little bit to talk more about how we do knee replacements and how we do robotic knee replacements. So who can benefit from robotics specifically is pretty much anyone. Younger patients want to be more active, need better alignment, better outcomes. And even an older person who may not be as active, but is wanting to do some things that in the past, knee replacement patients would have trouble with, just simply things like climbing stairs. So robotics helps everyone. So, okay. You're all right. We're getting there. So what is a knee replacement? Most people think that you hack it out here in the middle and down there and put a new hinge in between. But really, knee replacement is more like a resurfacing. A knee replacement, kind of like a crown on a tooth. You'll see in these pictures here on the screen that just the articular surfaces, the joint surfaces are replaced, and the ligaments around the knee stay intact. So the concept of resurfacing is a lot more appropriate a way of looking at this. So go ahead. Historically, when knee replacement is done, the incision up the front of the knee that split through the quadriceps, like you see in the upper right with a long red incision marked there around the kneecap, those are all knees that have different approaches into the knee. Minimally invasive surgery has been done around here for over 10 years, close to 15 years. We've been using minimally invasive techniques and smaller incisions. And it's pretty much the standard. And this helps us maintain that. We're going to go into that again in a little bit. When establishing alignment, if you see down below in the lower right-hand corner, those were the traditional alignment guides. They were holes drilled into the femur that a rod would go inside the femoral canal, or rods that are placed on the outside of the leg. All of those are big bulky jigs that were utilized to guide an oscillating saw to make the bone cuts. So as you can see in those pictures, those are bigger things where initially it was, here's a jig to help me make my cuts. Now it's more about, well, let's make an incision and figure out a way to work inside that incision. And Corian Robotics helps us, again, stay much smaller and less invasive when we do that, but also be more accurate than these much older physically alignment jigs based on a position of how it looks. Okay. Next slide. So traditionally, it was kind of like surgeon would give it an eyeball look and see how it looked from a long way away. And if you did a lot of them, it looked pretty good. If you didn't, sometimes they didn't always look so good. Go ahead, next slide. So what is robotics? We talked about knee replacements. Now we're gonna talk a little bit about robotics and what is robotics. Mechanical systems that are used to help the surgeon or guide the surgeon, in some cases even replace the surgeon's hands. Initially in orthopedics, computer navigation was used to guide placement of those jigs, kind of like a GPS, still used a lot in hip replacement. We use a lot of computer navigation here for hip replacement. You may have heard about the Da Vinci robot. Da Vinci has been around for a long time for intra-abdominal surgery, for general surgery, for prostate surgery. The Da Vinci robot is a surgeon makes an incision, opens the abdomen. It's a robot set up, and that surgeon walks away, sometimes to a completely separate room, and uses a set of joysticks, essentially, to manipulate the robotic arms and does the surgery, essentially, by remote control. What we'll see when we start talking about orthopedic robotics is this is all right in my hand, right in the knee. We're never turning our back on the patient. The patient's always right there with us as I'm doing the surgery and the robot's helping me. So different types of robots. This is not Johnny Five from the military. You may have heard of a Mako robot. Mako, kind of the first robot that was widely used. Mako is based on a CT scan that's done of the knee prior to the surgery. And then a plan is made based on that CT scan, and a robotic arm holds a oscillating saw that cuts are made. Uses one system, the Striker knee replacement knee, the Striker triathlon knee. I was using probably 20 years ago, but we've gone to a much more up-to-date design system that I like a lot better. The Mako is one robot, one system. You want to do a total knee, you got a robot. You want to do a partial knee, another robot. So next is ROSA, is a robot by Zimmer Corporation. Again, either CT or MRI based, again, still a robotic arm with a saw blade. They're getting more on their platform and it's more robust, but still limited by that saw blade. When you see Navio and Corey, what we have now is this is based on a digital model that's happened right during the surgery. We're gonna make that model. You'll see an example of that. It takes me about 30 seconds to establish an infinite point model in the computer. And then we're able to do knee replacements. Journey 2 is a much newer design, and we'll talk a little bit about the design in a bit, but a wide variety of different kinds of knees, of partial ligament reconstruction, total ligament reconstruction, partial knee replacements. Navio and Corey are the only systems that use artificial intelligence built into the system to help make that plan. So here's a couple pictures. On the left, you can see the Striker Mako, big robotic arm. The thing is the size of a refrigerator, robotic arm with a saw device on the end. And based on the plan, that saw is guided, and that saw blade, anytime an oscillating saw is moving, a saw has the capacity to potentially skive off of hard bone or hard structures and change the alignment. We see the neck in the middle is the ROSA, a little smaller, two structures there with cameras and screens and still that robotic arm. And then on the right is Corey. Corey is basically the size of your old VCR or your video game console, and has a tablet that is sterile. He preps on the field that I can handle, put my hands directly on. And that handpiece that you see there is a burr. It's a spinning tool like a drill or a router that essentially makes bone cuts by milling. We'll talk a little bit more about that. So this is not 2001 Space Odyssey with, sorry, Dave, can't do that. They don't control this. We're controlling the robot, but they are helping us. So why do we need robotics? I mean, lots of surgeons have been asked this question about why we need this. I've done 5,000 knee replacements and not as an exaggeration. I've seen this, I've done lots of them. I know how to do them. And I know what looks right. But when we study knee replacements and study knee replacement patients, up to 20% of knee replacement patients aren't totally satisfied with their knee replacement. When we look at them or look at their knee looks good. It tracks right. Their x-rays look good. The knee is balanced right. And that patient is simply not totally satisfied. They may not be able to do the things that they were hoping that they could do after their knee replacement. And so that has led to this 20% that we would like to be able to fix. That's a big number. So, any questions? So when we talk a little bit about designing the implant, trying to fix the design and to be able to fix that 20% of patients. Traditionally, when a knee replacement was designed, like you see in the middle here, chrome with stems, a design that wasn't even lefts and rights. They had one hinge that they would put in either side, and the design was surgeon driven. A surgeon would look at what he thought was appropriate and make a design, and some engineers would get together and they'd build it, they'd put it in some cadavers, and then maybe make some design changes, and then they'd start putting it in people. And that's how it was done. And that design may get 10 or 12 design changes before it was brought to market. Now, as you see more on the right-hand side of your screen, that digital model is made. Computer power has become so powerful that we can model an infinite number of points across the surface of a knee. CAD design programs are able to change the look of that knee replacement and make that fit more like a normal knee. We have rights and lefts. We have knees that accommodate keeping the ligament or replacing an ACL and a PCL. And we can do these kind of modeling and measure the stresses that it puts into the ligaments. These computers can test all of these things as we're building this design. So, he's coming. Now, we still know that baby boomers are the biggest population coming up and into the age group that is getting knee replacements. And they're not what the generation before was. They weren't are less accepting of limitations after their surgeries. They want to continue doing stuff like these, like skateboarding, jet skis, mountain biking, hiking, playing tennis, playing golf, playing skiing, snow skiing. Those are all things that we want people to keep doing if that's what they want to do. And so that wasn't always the case with knee replacements in the past, so that's what we're striving for. A little bit more, so you can see the difference in the design of this implant. As you look through these different designs, starting in the lower left of the screen, you can see that we have the ability to work with preserving both the ACL and the PCL if they're intact, or replacing just the ACL, or replacing both of them, and various levels of support. And as we see in that knee in the middle, lower middle, that it doesn't look equal. It's not a hinge like that first one was, because that's not what the knee is like. And this is designed so that that mechanical knee will very closely mimic the kinematics of a normal knee. And the kinematics are the study of the motion of a knee. So we want to know how that knee bends and straightens. And when you do that, does one part of the knee roll back and one part slide? All these factors are built into the design so that this knee, when it moves, feels more like a total knee replacement, or more like a normal knee, that as opposed to just that hinge knee replacement. I'm going too fast anyway. So robotic assistance. Robotics helps improve our accuracy. So we can measure, and we'll show you in a demonstration how we measure alignment and position and map the knee, and then allows us to better hit our targets. So as you see the target on the lower left, yeah, every shot is on the target versus the target in the middle where, yeah, everything is now grouped, but it's not quite centered, versus being accurate and repeatable, and every knee is exactly on target where we want it to be. When we assess ligament balance, or when we talk to, when you test surgeons, it says surgeons are pretty accurate, but there's outliers. Orthopedic surgeons, we measure ligaments and angles all day. We're looking at x-rays and measuring angles, and we're pretty good at it. When you get 1,000 orthopedic surgeons in a room and you put up on a screen an angle and have them estimate it, the studies show we're pretty good at it. Most people are within 3 to 5 degrees of just looking at an angle and knowing what it is. Problem is, you don't want your knee replacement within 3 to 5 degrees. If you want that knee replacement at 1 degree or 2 degrees or 30, that's where you want it. That's where you want to put it. And Corey now allows me to do that. If I decide that I want 1 degree in that tibia, I can hit that. And it does it every time. So allows me to assess the balance of those ligaments and the shape of the knee. And again, line that up and hit that target exactly every time. When we talk about partial knee replacements, traditionally they were based on those guides that we showed earlier that are outside the knee. They're very fuzzy. They very much relied on the surgeon giving it eyeball test. And they traditionally have a very low success rate or something that sometimes needs a lot of revisions. As many as 12% of partial knee replacements need to be revised. That's not a good number. And so that's because it's hard to be very accurate there. With Corey and robotics and artificial intelligence, if we want to put that in that 1 degree or in 0 degrees, we can hit that and hit it every time. You may notice our local guy there in the lower right-hand corner. He's been around. He's one of our patients here who's had a robotic knee and is super happy with his knee replacement there. Go
ahead. Got a couple questions.
Okay, fire away.
How soon after one knee is replaced should the other knee with the same arthritic issues be undertaken?
So it usually takes about 3 months. So the question, I don't know if you could hear it for sure, but how soon after one knee could a second knee replacement be done on the opposite side if both knees are bad? Lots of studies show after a knee replacement, the new knee becomes your good knee within a couple of weeks. But that new knee to really reliably support you through the rehab of the other knee probably reliably takes at least 3 months. Now it's also, this is a big surgery, it's a big recovery. There's a lot of healing that takes energy out of your system. And it can be draining. And so not everybody that wants it and will say initially, I want to do it right at 3 months, but I'd say the number of people that really are ready to do it at 3 months is pretty small. Some do it, but I'd say probably very few. Go ahead.
Yep, one more question. Arthritis, pain, and degradation that has changed my gait. How do you know how to balance and line up my knee to restore my gait?
Right, so the gait has, we watch everybody's gait when we come in with your very first visit, and we see that, and then we know what the overall alignment of your leg is. Prior to your surgery, we are going to get an x-ray that starts at the hip and goes all the way down to the ankle. So we know the overall alignment of the limb, and we're able to restore that more normal anatomy of the entire limb. And then able to work with physical therapy to be able to work on and restore gait. Does gait automatically come back because you have a well-functioning knee? No, a lot of gait is habit. And unlearning an old habit of a limp or unusual gait takes a long time. It can take several months, and maybe up to a year, to really make a limp go away completely.
Can you do both knees at once?
I used to do both knees at once. In my residency training program, we did it all the time, and that was the research that I did as a resident was on simultaneous bilateral total knee replacements. Multiple recent studies started with a study of about 60,000 patients from the Mayo Clinic, says that it is unsafe. The mortality rate, the death rate, is much higher if you do both knees at the same time. And pretty much most people are going away from doing that and not doing both knees at the same time. So no, the answer is could you, but yes, but no, it's not being done really anymore. been done a lot in the past. Okay. We're going to start to talk a little bit about CORI. So CORI is the Center of Real Intelligence, and it's the center because it's using that AI, artificial intelligence. Where we talked about before building a model based on a CT scan that was done maybe weeks or months before the surgery, this is all based on a digital model right at the time of the surgery. It takes into account all the any osteophytes, any cartilage defects, any cartilage that's still intact versus just bare bone. It takes into account the ligament balance. All of these things are accounted that a CT scan has no input on the ligament balance of the knee. You see there in the bottom center, the CORI handpiece. That's the robotic handpiece that helps do this. This is a burr that spins similar to a drill, works like a router as opposed to using a skill saw in your shop. A router or a CNC machine. When super accurate parts are being milled or made for a machine, they're usually milled with this type of burr device so that it could be super accurate. So, and then the other thing about CORI is robust, lets us do a lot of things and even change plans in the middle. If we come in with a design to try and preserve both the ligaments, but we get into a surgery and someone's ACL is not good enough, and we can't do that surgery, it allows me to just move right to the next plan and do a BCS or cruciate retaining or bicruciate substituting knee. And we can make all those changes without having to change any equipment out of the operating room as we do that. And hip is in our future. So, go ahead. So we're gonna go into a model. We're gonna do a little bit of setup here, get CORI kind of set up where you can see, and you'll be able to see kind of how it works. We have a practice bone that is called a sawbones that are used all over the world in practice surgeries. However, it makes a lot of dust and housekeeping would be really upset if I did that. So we're not gonna do that here today, but we'll get everything ready to show you where we will up to and into the knee. So your questions or?
Yeah, there's a couple more questions. With someone who's had a tibial plateau fracture be a candidate?
Certainly, actually a very good candidate. This is able to map out that old fracture and tell us exactly what we need to replace and align that back to a normal alignment.
Would someone who's had a knee replaced twice and is still in pain be a candidate?
Possibly. If we can tell that there's a reason why that old knee replacement is loose or not fitting or some other reason why we can tell that that knee replacement is painful, then yes, CORI can be used for revision surgery. However, we need to, just because a knee replacement is painful doesn't always redoing it, as we've already seen, if it was painful, it was redone once and it's still painful, that doesn't necessarily always fix the problem.
What's a typical recovery time frame?
Yeah, good question. So most folks, it takes a little while to get people ready. People have to get cleared medically, as we talked about at the beginning. And then most people spend one night. Some folks go home the same day. When this is done, the knee is cemented in place. You can put all your weight on it right from the beginning. And people walk with a walker for a week to 2 weeks and then a cane for a week or 2 weeks. When you first go home, and like I said, some people go home the same day. Most people go home the next day. People walk with, or therapy comes to your house for the first couple weeks that you're home. And then you go to outpatient physical therapy for a couple of months. All right, so let's, this is Marianne Madsen from Smith & Nephew who's gonna help me steer on the time for us. So I lost the foot pedal.
I gotcha.
All right, got it. Mm-hmm. And may Ryan have to have you maybe there. So, simulated knee has both ligaments on the sides, the ACL and the PCL simulated inside. And as we set this up, it's able to move from full flexion and extension. There's two arrays that are placed in the bones inside the incision that the computer can see. And those are pins that go in and then come back out. And as you see, Corey's in the background, has two cameras that can see these, and then the knows where we are. Everything's tight. Is that true?
Everything's tight. That one just needs to be flipped towards the ceiling.
Yeah. A little better. So yeah, part of the initial setup is making sure that the robot can see everything that we're doing through the whole surgery. And then we establish checkpoints here. Got it there. One on the femur, one on the tibia. And I can control this. There's a foot pedal here, or the screen, or even Marianne can help me with the screen there. See the pointer, there we go. And the pointer over here. And then we find a center point of the knee and a center point of the femur in the knee. All these points are helping the robot know where your leg is in space. Finds the center of the ankle, the center of the knee, and now we're going to find the center of the hip. See all this? Nope, I'm losing it. I'm going to start again. See femur. Wow, that's a big one. And try again. That's looking better. There we go. So then it finds what the extension of the knee is, how much flexion the knee has. And then this is the part where we build a digital model. So it's going to show me right here. You ready? I'm not seeing the femur again. I can move it out a little bit. There we go. Okay. Here we go. And you see, I think you can see on the screen that this is coming up and making points that are in the knee. And I'm mapping the whole surface. That's about done. I'll get a few extra points up here on the front. I like to get a little few extra on the side where ligament attachments are. And I can come back around. And it's nice that Corey says, hey, you need a little few more points over here, Dirk. And I'm going to flex her up a little bit farther. There we go. Can't see the finger. There we go. Okay. And then we make an alignment like this. Go ahead. All right. And then we're going to do the same thing on the tibia. And establish our alignment. Just sweeping across. There's a couple of big holes in the front of this tibia. So now, and can you see the screen sort of okay? I think I can bring that a little closer. We can bring this getting closer. And so there's not a lot of glare on it. So I'm able to make a plan on this knee. It tells me the sizes of the knee. We can make adjustments, moving side to side or up and down, lower and higher for the sizes of the knee replacement that would fit. Some of this is also templated off the x-rays before we start. And then the next step is checking the ligament balance. So move this guy out of the way again. There we go. And okay. So we can either work off the computer in the back that Marianne's helping with, or this that's right on the surgical field. Probably just blocked it. But as you can see, so the screen, and maybe you can see that a little more.
Yeah.
Look there. Never tried to do this before, but so it gives me input about sizing and adjustments, and as we fit a knee replacement, we can make adjustments that allow for these ligaments to balance out better. And we can use the same in, you want more of this, no? More the other way. So I can make these adjustments and balance this out. And then when I'm ready to go, Corey, we have a checkpoint that wants to make sure that we're performing this well. Am I out of the way?
You're good.
Okay.
Dr. Gouge, yes. Quick question.
Go ahead.
Is what you're doing now part of the pre-surgery exam, or is this part of the surgery?
This is part of the surgery. Okay. Yeah, this is all part of the surgery. And this, I'm going a little slower than I normally would. I don't have assistants, and I don't have retractors, and I'm trying to go a little slower than normal so that everybody can kind of understand the flow, a little bit of how we do it. So it's a little slower than normal. This probably takes me the whole process 5 or 10 minutes after we've made our incisions. Then we do this. And then once we're at this point is where the burr would be able to take off bone off the end of the femur. Now the burr is in my hand and the robot is helping me. If I try and, I don't know if you can see it, the burr is extended now. If I try and essentially color outside the lines, if I try and burr too deep or off the wrong side, the robot will pull that back and not let me go there. So the burr is always making sure that I'm perfectly accurate as we're performing this. And when you see these and our plan that put in 1 or 2 degrees of varus or 1 degree of alignment, it makes this exactly where we want it to be. It's all guided by the robotics. And we can work. Okay. So all this part is usually calibrated. Go ahead. There you go. Prior to the surgery. There we go. Like robots, they don't want to cooperate with a webinar. So, but so that's, this is the spot where I'm not going to, you can see, you can't see. On the screen, you can see the purple. And basically how I work is looking at the screen and the burr takes away the purple parts. I work through the purple, through the green, the blue and the green until I have a nice white flat surface. And this, I can turn it on, but it won't go anywhere until I get it close to the surface that it's supposed to work on. And so even when the burr is running, you know, it's safe. There's nothing to touch. Nothing can't hurt anybody. And so you can't go outside those color outside the lines, essentially. So we keep it simple in orthopedics. So we have any other questions about what robotics is in total knee replacement?
What are the differences between a partial and a total knee replacement?
Sure. So if someone has arthritis in their knee that's just isolated to one part of the knee, not involving the whole knee, then doing just part of that knee replacement feels a little more normal. We don't have to take out other ligaments like we would in a major knee replacement. And so they feel a little more normal and rehab a little bit faster. It used to be that knee replacements stayed in the hospital for 5 or 6 days. When I started in practice, it was normal for that. And partials were 1 day or 2 days. Now everybody is maybe a 1 day or go home the same day, and that's everybody, whether it's partial or total. So the gap of difference between a partial knee replacement versus a total knee replacement has narrowed how fast they recover. But a little bit more normal feeling knee in a partial if you're a candidate for that. It doesn't make sense to sit, if you have arthritis in multiple compartments, or one replace one and then have pain somewhere else. The reason to do this surgery is to make pain go away and allow you to walk better and be more active. So replacing something that's going to still cause pain doesn't make any sense.
For most candidates, how long is an incision normally?
So the incision is usually a couple fingers above the kneecap to just below the bump on your tibia, right below your knee. It's called the tibial tubercle. So obviously, a guy that's 6'8" is going to need a different incision than a female that's 5'2". And so it's variable, and can't say that it's, we used to, let me back up a little bit. When minimally invasive concepts came out, people were trying to promise that they would do a knee replacement through a 2-inch or 3-inch incision. And there was a lot of marketing about 3-inch incisions, and the pendulum swung that there was a lot of complications by doing that. The surgeon couldn't see what he needed to see. That pendulum has swung back. And now the incision is more about the appropriate incision with less invasive techniques inside that incision to make the pain much less for the patient, but have a good outcome.
Is it possible to overcompensate with the replaced knee and damage the replaced knee prior to having a second knee replacement?
No, the parts that are in this knee replacement, they are, as we saw in those pictures, the slides, they're metal and plastic. This knee is the only knee on the market that the FDA will say is going to last 30 years. So you can't wreck it. I mean, it takes a car wreck to wreck it or wear it out. We do recommend that people don't run for exercise. If you need to run, the knee will allow you to run. You can take a few steps. Say you're crossing the street and there's a car coming, you can run. You can get out of the way. But we don't want you to like run 5Ks with it, because you could potentially wear it out in your lifetime. In 3 months, no.
When's the determination made between a partial or a total knee replacement?
So usually that's a discussion that happens with the initial evaluation and the pre-op visit. And then the final decision is going to always be made when you're directly looking at the knee. If I have just talked about a partial, but I come in and someone's kneecap, their patella, looks terrible, we're going to have to convert, because I'm not going to do a thing that is going to continue to be painful. The reason we do this is to make pain go away. And it wouldn't make sense to do just that. So usually when we talk to somebody about a partial, it's going to be partial replacement, possible total replacement, so that they're prepared for either event.
Can you kneel on a new knee, and at what point after surgery?
Yeah, you can kneel on a knee replacement. You can't damage it by kneeling on it. There's been some older studies, you know, and the knee incision was always right down the front, right over the kneecap, right over that tibial tubercle bone that you kneel on. And so there's a pretty high percentage, like 30% of patients that find it uncomfortable to kneel on a knee replacement. It's, you can't damage it, you can't hurt it. You can kneel as soon as you're comfortable. And usually people will work through padding it and working up their tolerance for kneeling and be able to do some of that. And sometimes it's, you know, the surface. If it's a really hard thing, they may not be able to kneel very well. But most of the time they can't kneel on their arthritic knee very well. If it's padded, they can usually do it. Now, incisions are moved a little more to the inside, just a hair. They're not right over the bone, not right over the kneecap. They're a little more inside. And so that incision shift is also a little easier for kneeling.
Couple questions about the CORI system.
Sure.
How widely is the CORI used, and do other doctors at OMC use CORI for knees?
Perfect, yeah, great. Both myself and Dr. Hirschmiller are the joint replacement surgeons here at OMC, and we both use CORI on all our knee replacements. CORI robotic surgery is really taking off, and at a meeting I was at just a few months ago, in the Phoenix area, 29 hospitals, 28 or 27 of them all have robots of one or the other. And if you want a knee replacement done in the Phoenix area, it's going to be done by a robot. There's no one not using them. In our region, most of the hospitals now have robots. Port Townsend has a Navio. Swedish, most of them have Corey being up to date, and we were able to get into Corey and the most advanced robotics. There's only a few in our region, five maybe in the whole region. That's counting three states, yeah?
Yeah.
Okay. So, yeah, not very many. We're pretty far up there right now.
How soon after surgery can most people drive?
The national recommendation for driving is 3 weeks after a left knee and 6 weeks after a right knee on an automatic transmission.
The actual surgery itself, is it quicker for a partial versus a total, or do they take about the amount of time, same amount of time?
Take about the same amount of time, really. And the surgery itself takes me about an hour.
Do most candidates feel any numbness around the knee after a surgery like this?
Sometimes there is a, because of where the incision is, and there's a skin nerve that comes across underneath the kneecap, I would say everybody has a small patch of numbness next to their scar. Pretty typical if you've had any surgeries before, you'll notice some numbness around the scar is a pretty typical thing, and that happens pretty much every time in a knee replacement, and I tell everybody about it. I tell them, expect it.
That's about all the questions we have.
Any other questions out there? We have a lot of folks. I do appreciate everybody signing in, and I appreciate all your time. And thank you for coming and listening. And but that is all I have for today. If you want to stay on, I have a couple more questions.
Anesthesia in a surgery like this. Can you speak to how that works?
Anesthesia with this surgery is usually what we like to do is a spinal anesthetic. And then sedation, like you would feel in a colonoscopy, where you sleep through it. Some people want to be wide awake, and that's fine. Some people don't want to know anything. They don't want to hear that burr. They don't want to know what's talking, and that's fine too. After the surgery, there's a nerve block that's put into the femoral nerve in the front of the thigh with a little balloon pump that puts a Novocaine type medication near the nerve, and it drips on that nerve at 8 cc's an hour and lasts about 3 days. So that helps cover 60 to 80% of the sensation in the knee for the first 3 days. It's not 100%, but it does help quite a bit. And then, so those things are, we also put local anesthetic inside the incisions before we close everything up. So all those things have, what's been able to translate to much shorter lengths of stay. People are able to go home a lot sooner than they were 10, 15 years ago when we didn't do any of those things.
For the candidate that might have like a steroid injection in their knee, how does that interact with the total knee replacement and the timeline?
Yep, good question. Again, cortisone injection into the knee, some recent studies have shown that cortisone decreases your ability to fight infection. And we've kind of already, we've known that, but we didn't know how long that stuck around. We know now that that sticks around in your knee and increases your risk for infection for at least 6 months. So if you have a cortisone shot, you will not get a knee replacement for at least 6 months. And that's a Medicare database research. We know, just by following numbers, and that's huge numbers, hundreds of thousands of patients over many years and tracking infections. So those huge numbers are able to detect those little minute differences, what's the difference between 4 months and 6 months? Well, there's a difference. So, yeah.
A couple questions related to recovery after surgery. What is the role of physical therapy afterwards, and how soon are you able to shower after a surgery?
Yeah, I should have brought one. We have a dressing that is waterproof, silver impregnated. The incisions are glued shut, and there's no stitches, no staples to come out. The dressing is waterproof. You can shower right over the top of it. It stays in place for 7 days, and then comes off similar to like a command strip comes off the wall. They stretch it, and it comes right off. And you can shower right over that. like I said, physical therapy starts on the day of surgery, day zero, we call that. That you can get up right away and put all your weight on it right from the beginning, and continues, like I said, through the first 2 or 3 months after your surgery. It's a lot of work making a knee replacement. In the rehab of a knee replacement, the rehab is super important. All this stuff that I'm doing and trying to be as accurate as possible, if someone doesn't do their rehab, my job makes no difference. They're not going to do well if they don't do their job.
Does a cortisone shot in the shoulder affect knee total knee replacement?
No, cortisone in the knee would be what we'd be talking about. I would be a little uncomfortable if it was within a month of surgery. But it's not the same as in the knee.
How old is the CORI technology itself?
2 years? 1 year? Navio, it was the version of this before CORI. It has been on the market for a few years, but CORI came on the market in last December. And so, but the camera design, the computer work, are all things that have been around, but combining all these together and the invention of the hand piece, there was a different type of a piece that was more of a pencil, and my hand cramped a lot using that. So they've changed this because a lot of surgeons said that this pistol grip is a lot nicer. So they've changed a lot of those things that make the surgeon more comfortable. The arrays, the pins, all those things are smaller, so that it's gotten a lot smaller. Kind of like any electronics, right? The computer you're working on is way smaller than the one that you'd have had a few years before that. So as these things all evolve, they get smaller and work even better as time goes by. So, yeah.
What's the first step for someone interested in a knee replacement?
Yeah. So if you have knee arthritis and your step is see your family doctor and they would send you a referral. See you in the orthopedic clinic and we would talk about all of this stuff. We would talk about the arthritis. We get x-rays in our department and we have them all right there. So we can look at them. We show them to you, talk about everything from the beginning of, you know, anti-inflammatories all the way to surgery. And everybody comes to us at a different place on that pathway. And so we would talk to that person and figure out where they are in that pathway. And if they're ready for surgery, that's when we make that decision.
Okay.
All right, everybody. That's the end of questions. I appreciate it. Carl, I see you over there. So, all right. Very nice. Thanks, mate. Have a great weekend, everybody. Thank you. Signing off.